It's Vincas Krėvė. He's sitting here in this armchair. Perhaps only few of you know that Vincas Krėvė spent almost 11 years of his life in Azerbaijan, first as a teacher, then at the Council of Lithuania. He was known in Baku as Mickevich, Vicount Yosevich. After graduating the Imperial College of Kiev in 1908, he was appointed as a teacher of Russian language and literature to the Baku First Royal School. Abdulla Shaig, one of the prominent poets of Azerbaijan and further one of his colleagues and best friends, wrote in his memoirs.
I remember when he first time came to the gymnasium. Everybody was gasping how short he was. The director of the school damn fab even didn't want to give him upper classes, justifying that he was too young and he couldn't handle them. And the upper class children were an inch taller than their teacher. But Mickevich obstinately demanded upper classes. He insisted and didn't want to surrender, acting like someone who didn't understand what the real reason was. The dispute lasted for several days, and finally the director had to agree. After a bit, Krėvė gained success due to his broad knowledge and sincerity. The original education style earned him respect of all in the gymnasium. Even the director began to agree with his opinion during the meetings of council and appointed him as the head of the school-based library forever.
At those times, the name of Azerbaijan wasn't used, the name of the country. It was erased from the brains of people. There were attempts to kill the national ID by cleansing the language and religion. Only in a few schools they were taught Azerbaijan language, and it was done under the name of Aboriginal. Abdulla Shaig was among a few teachers who tried to enrich his people's mind and nurture his spirits with the precious pearls of Azerbaijan literature, a person of Azari wetlands. Vincas Krėvė supported and protected him in every way. One day, one of the wealthiest residents of Baku burst the staff from screaming and threatening Shaig.
Are you Abdulla Shaig? Stop to fill my child's mind with empty and useless lessons.
At those times, Krėvė was in the room as well. He was really upset of hearing such bitter words toward the native Azerbaijan language. He reacted very sharply, stepped forward and said,
"He who is ashamed to learn the language of their native people, he can't be called a human being."
These words sounded as a bitter slap to this rich man. In 1990-1912, Vincas Krėvė served at the Council of Lithuania in Azerbaijan. 27 March is the date of official annals of Lithuania-Azerbaijan interrelations, and the Council first functioned in his Baku flat. And work as a writer is considered the most efficient and prolific in his career. Such works as Sharuna's Duke of Dainava, Skirgaila, Sons of Heaven and Earth were written in Baku. The rich Azerbaijan literature and culture, as well as the sociopolitical environment accompanied with the violent events, had really strong impact on Krėvė's oeuvre. His Azerbaijan series of works include Azerstano Country, Contradict Forces, Bolsheviks, as well as the song about the eagle. These works brought mystical and magic Eastern spirit, unique imagine, artistic expression, fashioning similar metaphor system to the Lithuanian literature. They are collected in his book, Rita Pasakas. And the story is teaching here today. It's a fairy tale about the ancient Azerbaijan, the land of fire. A long, long time ago, in the land of fire, the happiest people lived. Once upon a time, I guess it will be better if Krėvė himself narrates it.
Most beautiful fruit of the land, where four elements of the nature come together.
Wow.
I want to tell you a tale about this mysterious country. A wise old man told me.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious and most merciful one, let the name of the holy source of all creatures be created and will be created in the world to be upon tongues of every prayer, Muslim, whose mouth comes blessing all day in the sunrise, noon, and sunset. In the fact, there is one God, and Muhammad is his prophet.
Once upon a time, there was a mystical culture of Azerbaijan. Angels and demons fighting with each other in the Lagorians. In the old times when the infidel was stabbed, the mansion, relics, and balance of Azerbaijan country, the people lived in peace and happiness. Angels held them in a way they were not ogres or pagans sowing the seeds of death and terror. The crop was plentiful and grew up faster. The sun was shining and the soul was generous to its residents.
People fulfilled all requirements of the holy book, and God extended his generous hand to them by making their life abundant and plenty. The blessing of God was like rain falling on the people of this rich country. At that time, everybody was glad and happy. No one knew what hatred and feud are. People who worshipped God treated each other as brothers with honor and glory. Their prosperity and wealth had been increasing day by day. Suffer. It was a land of happiness. The years passed in calmness and tranquility. The soil was giving them more and more harvest. They didn't even know where to store it. But the people became lazy. Deniers of God's commands, rancors and robust ogres have thought over the centuries how to seduce these God's faithful servants, although they couldn't find a way.
This moment the tale appeared. The first came to the first as a foreign merchant bringing her fabrics, gold and silver. All these things were so great and attractive, the sons of Azerbaijan had never seen before. In order to look at those items, people called across the villages and cities. They began to feel a tinge of wonder for not having those beautiful things. While seeing people's predilection, the merchant said,
"Your country is a country of happiness. All of you have equity, but if you want, you can live happy. Most of you have the crop that grows only in your lands, but I have such beautiful and necessary things from other countries which you have not got ever. You don't know how to reproduce them or use, but they are really useful things."
While the damn merchant talking harder was a full mouth, everyone listened to him with floppy ears.
"You speak very properly. There is not the slightest lie in your words. Say, how the beauty of these things can make us happy. After all, we don't even know how to prepare them, nor our women can knead these pieces."
Bring me how much harvest you can rear and steal. Get these beautiful things. Everyone can choose whatever he wants. I will determine the price. Who will bring more harvest, he will get more things. Let our children and women take these pieces and rejoice."
Devil has taken over all with the pleasant passes of speech. Everyone tried to bear as more they can do to exchange the harvest for the things that brought people disasters and envy. They began to put beautiful pieces and jewelry to show each other. Walking regularly, sparking the feeling of envy and jealousy in others who haven't possessed them.
Greed and envy invaded their hearts. Others and people began hurting each other, commencing feud and hostile. But the devil was not yet completely satisfied with the world. He wanted to turn away true God believers from their right way and lead them to the evil way, completely making them immoral.
The next time, the devil came to the lands of Azerstan as an educated mullah, who had pilgrimaged to the holy lands of Mecca and Medina, Kerbal and Mashhad, as well as other divine places. He was so convincing about such interesting and curious things existing in those places, even skillful pilgrims visited those places several times, couldn't say a word to prove or refuse it, just became silent in front of him.
People were flocking from different regions to hear his interesting stories. His popularity grew day by day. Everyone came to him for help and assistance, getting his precious advice. Everyone believed that he was a sacred. Once he addressed the prophet stating,
"Your country is a happy and glorious land. If you want to live a happy, don't dress yourself in bears. Live and dictate your immorality."
There wasn't an illiterate man who had scrutinized the whole books and being aware of God's judgment instructions to uncover the sweet lies of this imposter. Everyone had listened to him in despair. He was glorifying the life and morality of those infidels who neither accepted the presence of God, nor respected the messengers, nor distinguished between the white and rogue.
Step by step, people began to change their divine lifestyle. They began drinking alcohol, neither prayed nor fasted, nor did the cleaning work, but some inflicting devotion and lovery. time, people have forgotten God and began to live as infidels and pagans. They drank every day, built orgy parties, made fun and became dopey, as well involved in dirty business and turned away from God completely.
God's wrath fell on them. He called his frightened angel death and gave him control over the people of Azerstan. After thinking why the angel of death sent Azerstan land and massed a hierarchy. The real son of the demon was a woman heart full of fate. He grabs everything with his awake hands. He began to deceive and cheat everyone.
Hayke and his burglars bummed around, eating the bread of others' labor, drinking the tears of others. They strived to take the biggest pay, however, didn't see or know anything. They showed themselves as friends of the people, fraternizing with them, but properly hiding their hatred and betrayal. Being hypocritical, they did evil on the sly, masterfully hiding their intentions, plunged the dagger.
Unfortunately, the sons of Azerstan relied the full play of Hayke's burghers were late. They have already grabbed all people's wealth, people turned into beggars and poor. But they didn't ask for mercy and salvation from God. God was very impressed.
Fertile and rich Azerbaijan lands became a drought. That year, over the spring summer term, there wasn't even a drop of rain. All water in water wells, lakes, and rivers ran out, pastures dried up. The gardens withered yellow. The country became a steppe and wasteland.
Cattle had perished of starvation, didn't yield crops and lawns. Empty grain fields were naked, miserable, and poor sight, and famine were everywhere. Everybody was sleeping. Only burghers were happy. Before the wrath of God fell from the sons of Azerstan, they stirred all needed harvest and crop. They screamed with joy, rubbing their hands and said,
"Oh, now our market will be full and loud. We will get more benefits of we want. Real hand money will be poured off our hands. These days are our holidays."
Started to sell products, they had 50, 100 times more than the initial prices. Those who had wanted to buy product brought his wives and children to serve those ogres for a piece of bread. Famine could open doors which swerved couldn't do.
The third year was drier than the previous years. People came face to face with the threat of death. It was a day of destruction. Only at that disastrous moment, sons of Azerbaijan began to pray and ask for God's salvation.
You have compassion on them and send them Allah your hand and the light of hope. Allah your hand inhabited in Wuhan. He was very pious and devout man. People came to him for help. He put a condition. Instead of harvest and food, he would give them they should dig ditches and overturn the flowing water of the spring emerging near his house toward the wasteland.
He tried the freeholders of Azerbaijan country understand the importance and value of their lands, make it fertile and fruitful. In very short time, the wasteland turned into flower-bed gardens, as a result of joint efforts of people with a lot of harvests.
Thank you.
began to blossom like a snow. The steppe turned into the most lone and green pasture. People began to live in joyfulness and chant, praying God and greed to his mercy.
Life continued in such way. And the years passed, the old ones healed. People forgot all the evil infidels did them. But their son became a crossroad of different religions and nations, living here in peace and solidarity. Everyone equally used the harvest and growth of this rich land. There were no wars, no clashes. It became the happiest country ever.
But no Togers felt envy to this happiness and unity of sons of Azerstan and tried to deprive them from this blessing. They met them confused, showing their face to each other as strangers and enemies. It sparked strangers and panic among people. People felt into panic. Relatives and friends haven't recognized each other anymore. They even didn't accept God and his rules of the light to name the dark paths.
In those times, most violent and ruthless bloodbears came from the darkness of mind. Their numbers were up to the stars in the sky. They crawled as a swarm of locusts and damaged everywhere their feet touched. They plundered and robbed everything, put in a fire every place, every spot. Leaving huge ruins and doomed to death those who could not hide from their violence, they maimed, crippled and tortured people with brutality, collecting a heap of dead.
The people of Heyvagulu were scattered. Ditches and springs dried up and trees gone as withered and perished. One again turned into a vacuum steppe. The sons of Azerstan became slaves of blood bearers. In anguish and tongue, being howled and suffered for years.
Of old wise men narrated by Krėvė. Unfortunately, it ends sadly.
However, nowadays Azerbaijan, in fact, is a strong, prosperous and flourishing country with brave and courageous heroes gave their lives for freedom and independence.
Their memories and pay tribute to their souls.
God had pity and mercy on Azerbaijan's sons and bestowed his divine light on them.
Land flower but pasture.
wanting to turn bus, they sow the seeds of happiness and prosperity.
Today, Azerbaijan became the heaven. Mohan breathes life, tolling hands of its sons made it paradise.
To Azerbaijan, but its sons are strong enough to face them.
They are not slaves anymore. They are free. They have united under a roof of solidarity.
Christian.
I am Judaist.
I am Zoroastrian.
I am Orthodox.
I am Baptist.
I am Sunni.
I am Shiite.
I am Malakan.
I am Pagan.
I am Sufi.
We all, we're here, the members of different nations and religions, are living here in the land of fire. And the feeling of belonging to this country, to this homeland, ties us with the tight knot around this eternal fire. Let free, independent Azerbaijan live forever. Let there always be love, peace, and friendship all over the world.
Yaşa, yaşa, çok yaşa, şanlı Azerbaycan.
Thank you for your coming, and hopefully you enjoyed our performance. We dedicated this performance to the Independence Day of Azerbaijan, and hopefully Vincas Krėvė is now here, really happy somewhere in the skies for Azerbaijan people who get their independence and freedom first in 1918, then in 1991. And we commemorate his memory and the memory of all people who became messengers between different nations and countries, who became messengers of love, peace, and friendship. Thank you very much, and I wanna to thank these amazing guys. Please applaud these amazing guys. Precious, talented. It's unbelievable, but we prepared this performance only for 1 week. And it's their just first performance in the sand. So please applaud. I'm really proud of you all. Thank you very much. They believed in me. They believed in this project when everyone just refused to do it, but they believed. They didn't leave me in the middle of the way. I'm really proud of you. Thank you very much. My special thanks goes to Arif. Arif, responsible for music arrangements for the slide. Please put Arif here. Arif, come here. This is looking for you. And thank you very much for Aurelia for this as well. Thank you very much for all staff, as well as the International Relations Department. But my biggest, biggest thanks, of course. Support. I'm so sorry, but these guys, they represent Baltuka Cultural Organization. I want to thank Baltuka Cultural Organization and their head, Ibrahim Ak. I couldn't see him here, but hopefully he will come. I don't know, maybe he will just join us later.
I want to thank Baltoka Cultural Organization for support. I want to thank Baltoka Cultural Center. This is our Arif. Thank you very much, Arif. And I'm so sorry, where is the Elvar, our background voice? Elvar, please come here. One of my biggest supporters. Elvar, please greet him as well. So, but my biggest special thanks goes to Kastis Salaves, because he is a really amazing person. He helped us very much, and I wanted to say him thank you very much, because first he met me with Vincas Krėvė. I didn't know about him through Kastis Salaves, and we were in his home museum. We met there other staff, so thank you very much. And I want to thank everyone, Martin Hamzaev as well, because he translated this book into Azerbaijan. I get now from the translating. So thank you very much for all.
Thank you. Thank you.